And welcome back to the Private Cloud Jumpstart, creating and managing a private cloud with System Center 2012. I'm Simon Perriman, Microsoft Technical Evangelist covering private cloud technologies, and I'm joined in this next module with Adam Hall. And we're going to be covering application management. Adam, why don't you introduce yourself?
Sure, thanks, Simon. So my name is Adam Hall. I am a product marketing manager in the Windows Server and System Center marketing group. My role is to look after the application management scenarios of the private cloud. So everything to do with how we configure and deploy applications across both the private cloud and reaching out to the Windows Azure public cloud as well.
Great. So let's take a look at where we are in the agenda. So up to this point, we've given the overview. We've covered the infrastructure, so how we actually deploy the hardware, how we optimize that hardware for the private cloud. Sean came along and he spoke about service delivery and automation as far as how can we streamline and automate and standardize our IT processes. And now Adam's going to come along and he's going to talk about how we really enhance this and provide the best experience for our end user. And in this case, our end user is our application owner or application developer. So why don't you tell us a little more details about what we're covering in this module?
Sure. So throughout this presentation, we're going to do some slides and some demonstration around, we're going to start with the application delivery lifecycle. And so we're going to take a look at how we construct applications in a private cloud and how they're slightly different to how we do applications today. We're going to talk about scalability of applications, how we do application virtualization, and take a look at how we have a standardized approach to deploying applications across both the private cloud and the public cloud. Then a very critical part of the private cloud is availability and performance-driven SLAs. So we're going to take a look at how we do application performance monitoring and how we enable that and make it really easy to get that SLA-driven application monitoring inside System Center 2012 and across our private cloud. Okay. So I believe we've probably covered this a couple of times through the sessions today, but the System Center 2012, our cloud and data center management scenarios, are really pivoting around three buckets. We're going to cover in this session the predictable application space. We're going to talk about the application monitoring and diagnosis, the application manageability, and the very service-centric approach to how we do applications in a private cloud. As I mentioned before, I'm also going to cover a little bit about Windows Azure and how we enable that as well. So the flexibility and the delegation. Kenan would have set up the private cloud this morning. We talked about user roles and delegation. Sean was talking about self-service and how people can do basic deployment of both applications and infrastructure. And I'm going to show how we enable the application owner to do that in a self-service style, how they can operate their applications within the private cloud in that delegated model without the need to go back to IT and ask every single time. Now, what that means is we need a delegation model, but we need a way of having control as well. And we use the term delegation with control, that ability for IT to delegate out to the application owner to manage their application, but know that they're going to only be able to operate within the bounds that they are delegated to, and they're not going to get out of control and take over someone else's resources and kind of crash the whole environment, right? So I'm going to show you how we set all of that up.
So at a high level, you know, we've continued to get questions about how do we isolate components, how do we, you know, silo different owners, different application developers, even in like a hosted environment, for example. So what's the primary isolation model that we are going to be using here?
Okay, so isolation and abstraction happens at a couple of different layers. We abstract at the hardware up to the operating system level with the virtualization. We have the private cloud abstraction of all the resources into buckets and pools, and I might delegate down to you the ability to deploy 10 virtual machines as an easy example. You get to 10 virtual machines, it's not going to let you deploy an 11th one. At an application level, we have this construct called a service template, which Ken set up this morning, and that ability for us to deploy applications in the exact same way in the same at the same time.
Standardized, consistent, automated.
Absolutely. And within that abstraction of a service template, we have server at V. And so at the application level, we can now abstract the application away from the operating system. And all of these levels of abstraction on the way up give us more flexibility, more control, and allow us to set up applications so that they work the same way every time. If I install an application manually, I have to hit next, I need to configure things, I might miss a step, I take a coffee break, maybe someone goes on leave. With a virtualization package, I say deploy that application. It will go out the same way every time. It will ensure that documentation is updated. It will ensure that the CMDB has been populated through the automated processes. So it's really about all of that coming together, and this application space is about the net result of everything you've seen today from Kenan and Sean. This is how it lights up once you've done all of those things.
Excellent.
Okay. So delivering IT as a service, again, we're going to set up a little bit of self-service from an application owner point of view. We're going to take a look at what that looks like and where all of that work that Kenan and Sean did around configuring and deploying your private cloud, setting up all of that monitoring and operating, the automation that Sean talked about, all of those underlying infrastructure and abstraction components coming together. Now we're going to show you what that looks like from the application owner point of view and how I can really be able to manage my applications in my own way. Okay, so when we talk about applications, the scalable standardized applications, there's four things that we talk about. The first one is abstraction. We just talked about server at V and the way that we can take an application installation, put it inside a bubble, and then make that bubble available as an application for installation. For those of you that have worked in the desktop management world and have used the desktop app V product that's part of the desktop optimization pack, this is the server variant of that same application. You sequence an application, it captures all of the information about the application, the state and the configuration, and allows us to deploy that out in a consistent way. Now, the other thing that Server at V allows us to do is to do updating of applications in a very image-based way. So the ability to lift an application up, replace an underlying operating system, and then put the application back down changes the patch management paradigm a lot and enables us to really be dynamic about how we do on-demand configuration of applications at the same time. Consistency. Kenan set up service templates, and service templates has a very create-consume model. Kenan's world, the IT world, and VMM, Virtual Machine Manager, creating those service templates, populating them, doing their testing, and then moving forward to an application owner, being delegated out the ability to now pick that service template out and consume it and deploy an application out. I will only get prompted for the information required to deploy that application at runtime. The rest of it is all going to be done exactly as was configured at the back end. Insight, we're going to take a look at application performance monitoring and how we make it really easy with Operations Manager to discover applications, to be able to configure them for performance monitoring with a very simple wizard-driven approach and then be able to do dashboards and get insight into how you're performing against your service levels. And then that control, we're going to take a look at App Controller and show how we can have visibility of quota across both private and public clouds, how we can see what we have running and how we can operate within a delegated model and do things like manage the underlying virtual machines of an application without having any understanding of where they're running, what their names are, their IP addresses and that kind of thing. As an application owner, I don't know what's underneath the hood. I don't know what virtual machines are there.
Well, the bigger question, should you care as the application owner? Do you really care what server it's on, what IP address it's using? I mean, in some cases you do, but ultimately our goal here is to really abstract that, right?
Absolutely, that's exactly what we try to do. I may need to put a log onto my app server for some reason, but I don't know its name, I don't know its IP address. We expose that information with a very simple Silverlight console. So we're going to take a look at that as well today. The application delivery lifecycle in a private cloud is a little bit different, and we move to a very simplistic model. We have the application specification. This is, what is the application, what are the resource requirements, what are the operating systems that it supports, what are the database configurations, what's the runtime configuration, all of that information coming together. Now, an application specification gets really enabled in a service template. And the difference between an application and a service is that a service is everything about the application in terms of all of the information about the installation, but it's also all the configuration as well, the networking, the storage, the compute resources, the on-demand configuration. The application plus all that information comes together to be delivered as a service. Once that service template is created, and this is a very IT-driven kind of model, then we can do customized deployments. And that ability for us to pick up a delegated service template, enter in the on-demand configuration, and simply hit deploy and have it go off and do all of that work without me needing to know where is it at, where is the status at, it hasn't been done correctly, it's all done for me, and I can see where that's at all times. As we deploy the service out, we can monitor that. We can see how it gets added into all the routines. We're going to see how when we deploy a service, it gets lit up in things like Operations Manager. As you deploy a service out, it is dynamically configured as a distributed application in Operations Manager. As you deploy, you immediately start to get visibility of the health of the application as it deploys each step. And that will then synchronize around to Service Manager for CMDB, can be added into backup routines and so forth.
Now, there's actually a question that's come up asking around, can we host multiple apps within a single VM? Well, I mean, generally the best practice is you do want to really isolate applications. If you have two apps inside a single VM, that VM crashes, you've lost two services at once. There's definitely advantages to just having a single app inside a single VM. But what would your answer be to, is it worth or can we really isolate multiple apps inside a single VM?
So the answer is yes, and especially with server app V, allows us to encapsulate each application so that it's quite insular and it's not going to compete there. My bigger question would be, do you want multiple applications in a single service template? Because you're now managing the application as an entity with your SQL can be in or outside of the service template, but assuming that you are using a service template with SQL, the application, the web tiers, and everything together, do both of those applications get managed in the same way? When you update one, do you update the other? When you patch one, do you patch the other? When you change one, do you change the other? And that's really, that's an operational question that mm-hmm. only the end customer can know, but we can do both. You can have a service template that's completely just one app in its entirety. You can have a service template that has multiple applications in it. I'm even going to show you, I've got a service template deployed that only has SQL in it. So it's delivering SQL as a service. And it's just got multiple SQL Server installations all within one. So we can kind of mix and match there. I personally would look towards more service templates being an instantiation of an application insular and then manage that application as a whole. I think that would probably be the best way forward, but absolutely you could go either way.
Yes, you can. Great question.
Okay. First topic, defining scalable and composed applications and service templates. And you saw some service templates this morning with Kenan. We're going to touch on App Controller and Virtual Machine Manager in this topic. So the service template, and I'll just build this out because I know that this same slide is in Kenan's infrastructure, and that really brings together the create-consume model. You have the IT infrastructure, it's building the service templates, doing the pre-flight testing. And then from an application owner point of view, I'm the person who knows the application. I know what the hardware resource requirements are. I know how many CPUs I need, how much RAM I need, how much disk space I need. It's my role to advise IT about what the makeup of these profiles is. They can put the numbers in, they can test that it's okay, they can do the performance testing, they can show me how the application is running in Operations Manager. But it's really a create-consume model, and there is a definite handshake and bringing the worlds together of the application owner setting that specification and IT being able to configure it, and then there's a create-consume model coming together. It is very much a handshake, and I think it brings the application owner and IT closer together, working together on something rather than the sometimes combative situation of the IT pro versus the application owner and the finger-pointing that goes on around that.
And I mean, at the end of the day, that's going to be better for the business, right? You have all Absolutely. The teams working together, you're going to get faster delivery, standardized delivery model, more predictable service, so Absolutely. It's good for everyone.
Raising those SLA levels, being responsive to the business, being able to deploy an application out in a matter of hours rather than a matter of weeks. We're working with customers who are seeing the reduction on even just the delivery of a virtual machine from something like 6 weeks down to something like 6 hours. And it was purely the process involved on the handoff between teams. I'd like a VM. Sure, I'll do that. Fill in this form. You fill in the form, it goes into a system, it sits there for a while, someone gets an email, they go away. I've built my bit and now I've handed it off to Bob over there to do the next bit. And that, the most expensive thing in process, and I'm sure Sean talked about this, is the handoff between teams, where things fall into the gap between us. Sometimes someone doesn't pick up an email, someone goes on leave, someone takes a coffee break and forgets. That human element of that process is the most expensive thing, and reducing down the time and responsiveness is one of the biggest deliverables that we can deliver with this kind of model.
Now, do we have any real-world examples of, you know, where people have started adopting this private cloud model, and we have seen them go from, you know, the scale of months to the scale of days or even hours?
Yeah, so in our technology adoption program, our TAP program, these are our early adopters who have been working with the System Center 2012 products from their very early releases. We've got a number of case studies and references that are going to come out and be available to showcase how this works. And, we are building those out. We have a lot of information. We have learned a lot as to how people are picking this up. And certainly the model of being able to just deliver out consistency every time. Even something like a service template delivering a single tier, and all it does is just do a vanilla operating system. but it's the same every single time. You can inject in the server roles, you can inject in the features. You know when you say you'd like a web server that it's built the same way every single time. Those kind of things are just totally valuable to our customers, and even just that basic adoption of the service template shows us that we're on the right path and we've got the technology to deliver what our customers are looking for.
Excellent.
So when we look inside these application profiles, there's a few things that we can do that typically trip people up when they're deploying applications. The first one is compatibility. Which operating systems are our applications going to run on? Is it going to run on server 2003, 2008, 2008 R2? Is it a 64-bit application or a 32-bit application? Being able to define that application and which operating system it requires means that you don't get into that, oh, I deployed the wrong one, sorry, I'll start again. You know what it's going to be deployed at, you know that it's going to have the right features and functions and roles installed on it, and that it's the right platform. The definition, being able to say, this is my operating system and here's how it's configured. Things like time zones and product keys, the local admin password, joining domains, the ability to, when we do the SQL connections with DAC packs, being able to define what all of those are for a given template and deployment, and then when you execute that, being able to run pre and post scripts. A good example here are things like antivirus agents. You deploy a new operating system out and you want to make sure it's got antivirus on it. Well, can you put that inside the sysprep image? Do you want to inject it in afterwards? It actually depends. Some of the antivirus and other agents require to go on afterwards. Some can be inside the sysprep image. So that ability to set something up, deploy it out, and then run some post tasks allows you to do the end-to-end scripting and deployment of applications and operating systems really without needing to be a guru and writing massive long scripts in order to achieve that. You tick some boxes inside the service template, and then it's enacted on the way through. SQL, and this is a good question that I get asked, and I'll preempt the question that's possibly going to come through about should SQL be part of a service template or is SQL outside of the service template? And it's a very good question, and the great answer is it depends. And you can do both, and that's the good news. SQL, and it all depends how you're going to manage your applications. Are you going to manage your application as an entity? Is it going to be SQL plus application plus web front end, all the networking, and that's my app? Or are you going to have a big SQL farm and your app comes up and talks to SQL? Both are completely valid scenarios. When you want to put SQL inside that template, though, and have it managed as one entity, what we allow for in the service templates is that dynamic configuration of SQL Server. So we can do a dynamic configuration and deployment of SQL Server 2008 R2 and above, and that allows us to install SQL in a very specific way. It is configured with the right security modes, the right TCP/IP connections, all the DAC packs can be injected in, the authentication modes, how you upgrade SQL and what happens when you remove an application, all the run-as accounts, service accounts. That instance of SQL is configured exactly how you need it, and it is tuned for that application. And we can do that as part of a service template. You can have a SQL tier, and basically all you need is to have an installation media of SQL available either within a virtual machine or on a media share somewhere. And then the rest of it is all done in the interface. You tick some boxes, choose your service accounts, and the service template will do the rest for you.
Great.
Excuse me. Then we move on to application resources, and this is a great conversation where people have line of business applications that change on a regular cadence, or even just change on an irregular cadence. The ability for us to manage those underlying resources. This can be anything from a developer has handed off a service pack, an update, and we need to get that update into the library. We need to get that into Virtual Machine Manager. We need to get a service template updated and tested. How do you take the handoff of the file? So I'm going to show you shortly in a demo how we do that in App Controller. But there's also the maintaining resources between environments. So that ability to have a dev, test, and production environment, how do you keep them consistent? How do you keep everything up to date? And so we have two different levels here. We have the IT view, which is the system administrator view that you see on the screen now, and that's about having two different libraries, and libraries are file-based shares that are parsed by Virtual Machine Manager and then loaded into the database. So you can keep them in sync at the file level, whether that's Robocopy, DFSR, the content synchronization tool of your choice, something like Orchestrator, that can do a sync when something changes on one side, copy it over to the other. That's kind of the base level. from an application owner point of view, we have the self-service style option where in-app controller, you can copy and paste, and it literally is a copy and paste, a service template from one environment to another. When you do that, it takes everything about that application and replicates it from one environment to another. That's all the VHDs, all the application files, all the scripts, all the configuration, everything. You copy, you paste, and App Controller will do the rest for you. And I'm going to show you what that looks like in a demo shortly. But that ability to say, I'd like to take a copy of my application from one environment and make it available and deployed in another. Totally delegated down to me. I still have to operate within my quotas, but I can do it all myself. So with that, we're going to cut across to demo, and we're going to take a look at how we manage those application resources, both in the private cloud, but also I'll touch on how we do that up to Windows Azure in the private cloud as well.
Okay, great. Now, as you launch this demo, what are the different components that you're going to be showing us here?
Sure. So I am going to be working with an app controller in this demo, and I'm going to show you how we do the file resource management in app controller. So this is App Controller. App Controller is a new component in System Center 2012. What you're looking here is the main interface where we have a number of items that I'll point out. The first is that App Controller is aware of my identity. It knows who I'm logged in as. I'm logged in as my demo user, Chris Johnson here, and he has access to a number of resources. These are Active Directory usernames that are logged in. I get access to and see the status and quota for my private clouds. You can see I have access to two Virtual Machine Manager private clouds. You can see the sum total of the resource availability that I have. I have a number of virtual machines, processors, some storage, memory that's available to me. I also have access to three Windows Azure subscriptions. App Controller, one of the things that it does is allows us to take Windows Azure subscriptions and then delegate them out to Active Directory users and groups. So we can do a mapping in both read-write and read-only ability for individual Active Directory users or groups to have access to Windows Azure subscriptions in a matrix model. Then I get a summary of what I have running in my environment. I have a number of Virtual Machine Manager services, I've got six of those. Under that are 26 virtual machines. We've got one machine that's turned off, so I get a warning that something's going on, and I've got a number of Azure services running as well.
Okay, so briefly, you know, let's not spend too much time talking about Azure. We are focusing on the private cloud, of course, here. But how easy is it to move a VM between clouds? A VM from my private cloud, want to move it to my public cloud. How exactly does that process work?
So that's not something we can do today. With Virtual Machine Manager 2012 and Windows Azure, we don't have the ability to move a virtual machine from one to the other. That's something that we may look at in the future, but today that's not a capability that we have. If you're talking about two Virtual Machine Manager clouds, then it would be an export-import process to achieve that today.
All right.
So we have a number of clouds available to us. So I had a summary on the front view, and here we can see we have a production cloud, and we have a staging and development cloud. So I get a breakdown at a more individual level as to what's going on. Jumping down a little bit, we talked about managing virtual machines, and I have a number of services running, but I don't know what's running under the hood. I don't know what all the virtual machines are. App Controller allows me to see what all these virtual machines are that are running underneath. We can see which service they are associated with, and depending on what I've been delegated, we have the ability to operate these virtual machines. I can shut them down, I can take a snapshot, I can store them into the library if I want, and I can even do a remote desktop or remote console to those machines as well. If I take a look at the Services tab, now I get to see the status of my applications. I have six applications running in my private cloud here and a number of hosted services running on Windows Azure. You can see a couple of different statuses here that I'll touch on as we go through, but I can get a very quick view as to what's going on. Now, going back to the purpose of this demo, where we take a look at how we manage the application resources, I'm going to start with Windows Azure and cover that off and then move on to the private cloud. So Windows Azure has a concept of storage and containers to do that, and Windows Azure works on a package file and a configuration file. I literally can copy and paste files off a standard file share in App Controller and upload them into Windows Azure by doing a copy and a paste. It will take these files, you can see they've got the upgrade file update process is going on. It's just going to copy those up. They'll then be available to me to deploy that hosted service into Windows Azure. And there you go, you can see we just uploaded those two files into Windows Azure and we now have the ability to see those. In a private cloud, I get to manage the underlying resources. So you can see I had two private clouds that I had running here. We've got our staging and development cloud, and I have my production cloud. I have a template here, and if I take a look at this, I would like to be able to replicate this application from dev and test and promote it into production. I literally can copy that, move across to my production template library, and once that does a little refresh, I can hit paste. That's kind of how hard it is to move an application or copy an application from one environment to another. I now get a very rich diagram view which breaks down for me. These are all the components that come together to make up my application. This application has three tiers. There's a virtual machine manager, virtual machine drive, I should say, in each tier. That's the virtual machine that's running. I've got my server app packages. I've got some scripts that are running, and they all come together. And from here, I can see which files need to run from one environment to the other.
Well, as we're talking about multiple environments, there's a question that's come up about, you know, moving code between dev and test. More specifically, I'm working in Visual Studio. I'm a developer. Is there a way that I can just push my code, push my app directly into a cloud? Or what's that process of taking it from Visual Studio, mm-hmm. handing it off to my IT department to getting that service up and running?
Sure, good question. So in a private cloud, it depends on how you're publishing that application. If you're compiling it as a traditional app and it's an MSI or an XE kind of thing, you can hand that off, and you just saw I was working within the file share. You could literally put on a file share and alert your application manager to say, there's a new version, go get it. The application manager could then copy and paste it into the library. If your application owner delegates you that right, you as a developer could simply publish directly to that file share, which would then mean that it got landed into the library. Once it's in the library, it can then be compiled into the service template. And that's somewhere where typically it's probably not a developer task. It's mm-hmm. typically an IT pro task. So getting the file into the share is developer. Once it's there, the IT pro can configure the service template. If it was a server at V package, then we can do a few extra things. Server at V allows us to do updates over the top of existing applications in a service template. So therefore, we could have the developer take a copy of our service template, inject in the new server at V package, test it, make sure it works okay, and then give it to us and say, here's your new service template. IT pros can then do their testing. They can make sure it's okay. It's going to meet SLAs. Nothing broke. We're all good. They can delegate that out to an application owner who can then hit the upgrade button. And literally, that's what it looks like. And tomorrow, when we go through monitoring and operating, I'm going to show you how we actually do that. And we'll upgrade an application as part one of the demos.
Great.
So to finish off how we copy and paste between environments, you can see we have some green ticks here. What that means is that those application resources already exist in the environment. App Controller has mapped them. It's done a compare. And it's got both the same version of the file, same application resources are there. For the ones with the red star, this is where we can choose to either copy that file from the other environment into the new one, or we can map it to existing. This service template, I've got a staging VHD file here, which is just a blank VHD. We don't want to be copying 40 gig of VHDs between environments when the base platform is exactly the same. So we're going to do a map to existing, and that's going to bring up all the existing resources that are in our private cloud. And that allows us to then map to our Sysprit image that's exactly the same, and it's going to remap that on the way through. We'll map each of those on the way through, and when we hit OK, App Controller is now going to duplicate that service template and all of those resources across from dev and test into production and be available to me as an application owner. So I know that this is an exact copy of what I have in dev and test because it was a copy paste of a service template. And so that's how we do application resource management across both a little bit on Windows Azure and in the private cloud as well, managing all those underlying files and being able to, as an application owner, have access to those in a delegated fashion. So I will jump back. I need to minimize that down. Okay. So now that we know how to do all that underlying application resources, all the service templates coming together, we're going to take a look at how we deploy applications, which is the critical bit. We've got everything staged. We're all good to go. We can now deploy out. How do we do that? So server at V. Server at V has four sort of parts to it. The first is the sequencing. And this server at V literally is a install and capture mechanism. You start it, you do all the installation, you configure your application, and it will capture everything that you changed on the way through. Once that is captured, you can then move into deploy mode. It enables us to have that application as a template in our library, injected into service templates and deployed in the same way every time. Moving into updating, that self-service application management process of a new file comes in, as we just talked about, it's updating, and we just want to slip that over the top. Or we've got an operating system update. Patch management is very different with ServRatV. And that ability that we have to export off the application and all the stateful information, put a new operating system underneath that's been patched and updated, and then put the application back on. We can scale out, do one upgrade domain at a time, ensure that the application is always available. And then from an availability point of view, that process that we just went to means that we can always make sure that there is an instance of the application available as we go through this. You don't need to reboot servers, you don't need to take them offline in order to do those kind of updates. So what can we actually do with ServRatV? From a host perspective, we're talking about Windows services, we're talking about IIS, web applications. We can capture those into web deploy packages. We capture all of the user accounts, things like local system, network service, domain accounts, local users and groups. They all get captured as part of this process. When you have a service as part of your application, when you deploy your ServRatV package, ServRatV dynamically registers that with the service control manager, and you actually see it dynamically pop into the service control manager, and from an operating system point of view, you can't tell the difference on how they're running. Resources, things like application binaries, all of the COM and DCOM, text-based configurations, INI files, those kinds of things, WMI providers, SQL Server, reporting services, configurations are captured. Registry settings, of course, COM objects, the .NET components themselves, things like the .NET runtime, .NET 3, 4 and so forth can be encapsulated, and you can drop those down. Java applets can be captured. So all of this comes through. And a common question that I often get is, well, what applications can be sequenced with ServRatV? It's a great question. The answer is it depends. Sorry, but it is. And the only way to know is to actually put it through the sequencer. All of this says this is what we can capture. Unless your application is doing something a little different and making a call down to an operating system that is a little different, we should be able to capture it okay. And the simple reason is, if you think about an operating system and an application, we're putting an agent in the middle, we're putting a shim in the middle, and basically everything the app does needs to be able to talk through that shim. If you're doing something that we're unaware of, then it's likely that it might not work.
Let's circumvent that. We miss Correct. That piece of data, we can't capture it,
Absolutely.
It gets missed in the sequencing.
And there are some applications that do some strange things that are coded in a particular way for a very particular purpose. SharePoint's a great example. Okay, we can't put SharePoint into a ServRatV bubble today. That's simply because SharePoint was created long before ServRatV was created, and the SharePoint team are deeply integrated into IIS and deeply integrated into the operating system, and we literally just can't get in between those two things, because in order to make SharePoint do all the wonderful things it can do, you know, they've done some very fantastic coding, and we just can't get the shim in between. And it's just a big, complex application like that can be quite hard to virtualize. But if you've got an application that is a fairly standard installation, it's got files, registry entries, COM settings, and services, then we should be able to run that through, and only testing is going to show that.
What about our custom applications? So we have plenty of end users out here. They have a line of business application. Can they do ServRatV for that?
So perfect question, because the target for ServRatV is line of business applications.
Great.
That is the primary target for ServRatV. It's not the big heavy workloads like the exchanges and the links and the SharePoints. Those are fairly big infrastructural products, right? They do a lot of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Line of business applications tend to be very database driven. They tend to be files, registry keys, some services, and then talk to a database, right? Those are the targets that we have, because they update on a regular cadence. They're fairly traditional in the way that they actually run, and they typically don't make custom calls down to IIS and down to the operating system. So that is very much the target for ServRatV.
Great.
Deploying the applications, we talked about ServRatV and that dynamic runtime information. So that ability to have a single version of an application and deploy it in multiple ways with runtime configuration coming through. And that ability that we have, when you configure the service template, you can do things like prompt for a username and a password. That could be different in each instantiation of the application. You might ask the user for what their username and password is. You might ask for a particular string. Maybe you want a cost center. It could be anything that you want to put in there. And we can do
in the runtime configuration, we do both mandatory and non-mandatory, so you can have optional components as well as mandatory, and then we do the encrypted settings as well. So that is very field-orientated. For each setting that you want, you specify whether it's mandatory and encrypted. If it's encrypted, you'll see the little dots that you see on the screen there, and no one knows what the password is. And you can also leverage run-as accounts as well. And run-as accounts from an application owner perspective are fantastic, because you might have a domain administrative account that is required to deploy my application. I need to update the schema of Active Directory. I don't need a domain admin account, and in most cases I don't want one because I don't want to be responsible in case something goes wrong. You can delegate to me the rights to use that application without ever having any knowledge of what the username or the password is. Great. If I leave the organization, you know I haven't got that username and password because I never knew what it was. Okay, so you can very much separate the security aspects of the application as well.
Very nice.
So from an application self-service point of view, when we move into this model, we've created our service templates, we've packaged everything together, then we move into the deployment mode. And so this is done through App Controller. App Controller is all about application self-service. When we go to deploy, I'm going to show you what this looks like in a demo in a sec, the quota is enforced. So I can't even start to deploy an application if I don't have quota to complete it. I'm not going to get caught in a half-deployed kind of mode, and I'm not going to be able to go over my bounds as well. We can take advantage of all those standardized templates. From an application owner point of view, it's very role-based. I have role-based access to content. I can't deploy an application that I don't have access to. Okay, so that delegated model comes through. And then from a single management point of view, we just touched on an app controller. We could see the Windows Azure hosted services as well as the private cloud services. We could see the instance count. And when I go through the deployment that we're going to do in a sec, then we'll see the structure of the application coming through as well. Because I may not have had any visibility into the service template until such time as I go to deploy it. So we're going to do a demo on application self-service. Again, this is going to be all about App Controller. Okay, so we can see that our template has been copied successfully across, and we're now there. So on the front page of App Controller, we can see here that we have a link to deploy a new service or a virtual machine. And that's a good statement to come up with, that self-service deployment is not just about service templates. I might just want a virtual machine. All I want is to be able to go and say, I'd like a new virtual machine, I want to develop something, I want to test something, for whatever reason. You can do service templates and VM templates as well. When we go to do a new deployment, the first thing it's going to ask me is, where do I want to deploy my app? Chris, as my demo user, has access to two private clouds, a staging and development and a production, and also the Windows Azure subscription. So the first thing I need to define is, where do I want to deploy? As I choose a cloud, I can see what my quota is available at a cloud level. And quotas light up at three different levels. They light up at the cloud level. How big is my cloud? That's everything together. Then we have role and user-based. And it's basically, cloud is this big, I get this much for my role, and then I get this much for me, myself. And so you can get very granular about Chris as an application owner gets a slice of a role, which in turn has a slice of a big private cloud. And then you can get into the question around how, when you deploy out, do you have multiple private clouds or do you have single applications per cloud as well?
So how does this integrate with Active Directory and Active Directory groups?
Sure. So all of the roles are set up within Virtual Machine Manager, and every single role that you set up is associated with either an Active Directory user or an Active Directory group. So ultimately, it all goes back to Active Directory. This is all group-driven. You can create roles in Virtual Machine Manager. You can associate quota and delegation to resources. But then that role simply points back to Active Directory and says which user, which group has access to which roles. All comes together.
So a slightly broader question then. Systems Editor 2012, all of the components. What type of dependencies are there with Active Directory?
Okay. So they all require Active Directory. Some of them have integrations, things like SPNs and pointers. So when you want to do dynamic discovery, there are pointers inside Active Directory to say, hey, Ops Manager's over there. So if you want to do the automatic discovery as a virtual machine comes into the environment, Ops Manager discovers it, and you want to dynamically direct it, you can have Active Directory pointers that say, hey, it's over there. So they all have a reliance from things like service accounts. Mm-hmm. So they all need to run as a service. So therefore, there's a service account model. There's a delegated quota a delegated model in terms of Active Directory users and groups. There's metadata inside Active Directory in terms of the ability to pointers. And then some of them even have schema updates. So if you look at some of the configuration manager settings, for example, there's actually a forest update and a schema update to do some of the functions. So they all require Active Directory, and they integrate, they leverage Active Directory, and some of them tightly integrate as well.
Great.
Okay, so we've chosen our cloud. We can see our quota. Once we select that cloud, we're now asked to select a template. We've selected a cloud. What is it we want to deploy? So as this updates, this is running live, and what this is going to do is pull back from Virtual Machine Manager all of the service templates that I have access to and been delegated down. You can see I have some virtual machines, I have some services. I've got a very big service template here. I've got a SQL platform that is supersized, and this has a lot of resource associated with it. And you can see that I have some nice red numbers there with negatives against them. And you can see that, you might not be able to see, but the OK button is grayed out. I can't even initiate the deployment of this service because I don't even have enough quota to start. Okay, so the quota is kicking in, I can delegate down, and if I wanted to deploy something like that, I could not. We're just going to deploy a very basic template here, and you can see that I do have capacity here, and it tells me what am I going to have left when I'm finished. We select that, we hit OK, and now I'm going to get that diagrammatic view and the structure of my application. This is the service template being put into a Silverlight console so I can configure it for deployment. I can configure the service itself. That allows me to give it a name. So we can say, like, new application. It's got a description, so I could say that this is my BI platform. It could be anything. If I could spell, would really help a lot. I can put a priority on that. I can associate a cost center if I wanted to, and any other settings that were available. Now, those service settings that we talked about, if there were any available, and with this it's a very basic template, then they would be lit up here as well. For each individual tier, we can also configure details about that if we're delegated. So you can see here that we have an automatically generated service as computer name, SQL hash hash hash. Basically what that means is that it's going to name the computer SQL and then the next incremental number. I have a number of SQL servers running. It's probably up to probably 14 or 15 by now. So it would just pick the next available number and make it SQL 017. Okay. I can see the name and description. I can see the network adapters and what they're connected to. I can see here that I do not have access to change that network. It would be bad for me to deploy an application to a network that's not the right network because it simply won't work. Once we go through there, we hit the deploy button, then it's going to trigger off that deployment, and away it's going to go. So that is now going to trigger off. You can see that we've got a service deployment. So that's how we do the self-service deployment of those applications. It's going to tick through. It's now going to trigger off. If we go across to the jobs, we talked about being able to see how it's going. You can see that the job is in progress. I can see where it's up to. And as this updates on the way through, Virtual Machine Manager will update App Controller, show me where it's at. I don't need to call IT. I don't need to see what's going on. That job actually failed. It's quite interesting. Probably don't have capacity available. You can see it has created it. No, it hasn't even created it. So we've got a problem at the back end. At least we tried the deployment, and it's on the way through, and away we go. So,
but we're not blaming you here.
No.
Go blame Canon for this one. He's the infrastructure guy.
This is my demo environment, so quite possibly I'm trying to do something that I'm not allowed to do. So, but that's how you do the deployment. It's on the way through. I've been delegated down the rights to those resources, and as we deploy them out, it will deploy out and let me know. At least it told me that it had failed. That's the good side of things. I knew that it didn't work. I can now follow up and go, hey, what happened with that? Like, was something unavailable? Did I choose something? Was there a problem with the service template? At least I'm aware of what went on. Okay, let's tick on through. So once we've got our applications out there, when we define the availability and performance, we're really starting to move to an SLA model. And this is where we move away from the traditional availability monitoring and start to look at performance monitoring. And there's quite a difference there. So the next few slides are going to explain what those differences are, and then we'll take a look at how we enable that. We're going to live inside Operations Manager now. We've moved away from the deployment, the delegated models. Our application is out there, and we want to know that it's performing to the level that we agreed to as part of the service template creation. So Operations Manager has been around for a long time. We go back to sort of 2000 and the first iterations of where Operations Manager came from. And we've done infrastructure monitoring with management packs for a long time. We've got a huge ecosystem out there and the ability to monitor just about anything on the planet, whether it's hardware, whether it's an application, whether it's an operating system. There's all sorts of management packs, and you can monitor just about anything. So we build on top of that with the network monitoring that's new in Operations Manager 2012, and then we build on top of that with application monitoring as well. So application monitoring has a requirement that you know about the underlying infrastructure before you do it. And the simple reason for that is, if an application's running slow, how do you know it's a problem with the application and not a problem with a bottleneck in the infrastructure? What about networking? What about storage, compute resources? If you don't know where the problem is, you can't resolve it. And that's what application performance monitoring is really about, is pinpointing where the problem is. With the Avicode acquisition that we did 2 years ago, we now bring in the ability to take a look at server-side and client-side performance monitoring. Server-side is about monitoring the code execution at the back end. These are the servers that are running in the data center. They're running as services, and they are performing transactions against the clients that are running. And so we can monitor inside those applications. Client-side performance monitoring is about knowing what the end-user experience is like. When Simon launches the website and runs up the application and tries to use it, what actually happened? How long did it take to load? Was there network latency? Did it actually work? Did you get any errors thrown up? Getting all of that information together. And then synthetic transactions. These are pre-recorded test paths through the application. And this is really about availability and response times, and about making sure that does the application function as it was designed to function. It's not going to tell you whether it was really performant or not for the end user, but at least it's going to highlight, yeah, it seems to be working. That's really the point that we're at. The client side is going to tell you what your experience is like, and the server side is going to give me the back-end data center view. And those three things together on top of infrastructure monitoring allows us to get a complete picture across all of our applications infrastructure.
Yeah, I mean, I just really want to emphasize that point that you brought up. You know, when we think about monitoring, right, it's not just monitoring infrastructure. It's not just monitoring VMs. But what really matters to the end user is the application itself. Okay. So with System Set to 2012, with the Avicode acquisition and that deep insight performance monitoring, you're really going to get the best end experience for monitoring any app in any data center.
That's correct. So configuring application performance monitoring, and I'll show you what this looks like in the demo as well, but just to set it up, one of the most powerful things that we got with the Avicode acquisition and the integration of Avicode into Operations Manager, we had a reduction in infrastructure, of course. Instead of having Ops Manager plus Avicode, we've just got Ops Manager, but we reduced down to a single agent. So there is one agent that does Operations Manager and the performance monitoring as well, and we do a discovery. So enabling application performance monitoring is as simple as running through a wizard, seeing which applications have been discovered, and turning it on. That literally is how easy that it is. We do this through the APM management pack. So basically, you import the APM management pack into Operations Manager, allow it to go through and catalog all of the applications on the of the servers and the agents that you've got, and then the list that is populated allows you to then configure. You simply turn it on. And the one thing that I can't help you with is the threshold. I don't know how fast your application should run. That is something that an application owner and a business needs to decide. What is the appropriate threshold or appropriate service level agreement that you should have for that application? I can't help you with that. You might have an app that takes 5 seconds to run a transaction through, and that's okay. Maybe it's 30 seconds because it's a really latent application, and that's okay with you. Or it might be like a highly performant application doing thousands of transactions a second, and anything longer than sort of half a microsecond and you're in trouble, right? So that's the one thing that we can't do for you, is set that threshold. And then from a client side, with application performance monitoring in Operations Manager 2012, we have the ability to do IIS.net web applications with the performance monitoring, and we will look to build that out and bring more of the Avicode acquisition in over time. But we can turn on the client side monitoring, things like the page load times, ACF, or AJAX and WCF, sorry, I should say. And really, it is tick box kind of stuff. It's a wizard, you tick it, you turn it on, and it works. So With that, I want to jump back to demo again, and because a lot of this stuff looks better in a demo than it does on slides, we're going to take a look at Operations Manager and see how we actually discover these apps and turn it on.
Now, I actually have a question. Just want to take a step back to the app deployment again. So
sure.
Use an app controller. As soon as you go and deploy an app, is this change registered in the Service Manager Configuration Management Database, the CMDB? And can you also integrate this as part of any type of orchestrator workflow, such as, you know, I've gone and deployed an app, I now want to automatically configure monitoring and do X, Y, and Z with it?
Great questions, and I think the best place to answer that is in the demo, because I can actually show you what that looks
like.
Even
better.
Look at that. Okay, so let's jump over to Operations Manager, and I'll answer the first question. So how does it become available and register the fact that we deployed it? This is the distributed applications view in Operations Manager. There is a connector between Virtual Machine Manager and Operations Manager. When you deploy a service on a Virtual Machine Manager, it is automatically synchronized across to Operations Manager and dynamically builds these diagrams. So if we take a look at our Customer Demographics service and open up the diagram view, there are no Operations Manager agents on these servers at all. I have not deployed the Operations Manager agent to the servers that are inside this application. Virtual Machine Manager, through the management pack of Virtual Machine Manager, dynamically builds this diagram, shows me what all the tiers are, and allows me to drill down and take a look inside. You can see that I see the tier, I see the virtual machine that's running, and clearly there's a red X, so there must be a problem there, and I can even drill down and start to get information and keep going down and down and down into the network configuration, the operating system, and the underlying VHD that's part of that as well. There's no agent on there. That's just Virtual Machine Manager talking to Operations Manager. Now, there's then also a connector from Operations Manager to Service Manager. And every distributed application in Operations Manager becomes a business service inside Service Manager. And so now we've got this, I deployed it, I'm monitoring it, and it's in the CMDB. Closed loop, everything coming together. Service Manager captures all the underlying pieces of information, the service template constructs and those kinds of things, and it's really that closed loop monitoring. Now the second part of that question is things like Orchestrator and picking that up. So what I showed you was a completely delegated model where I deployed the application and it was in a service template, it was ready to go. You've got two options with things like Orchestrator. You've got the options to, instead of using App Controller, go to something like Service Manager. Sean showed you the service request management tool and request the deployment of that service. That would then trigger Service Manager to call Orchestrator to go do that deployment on my behalf. It's sort of a delegated model in that I can request it, but I didn't go and do the deployment myself. So you can absolutely do that. Or you could have Orchestrator polling Operations Manager and say, hey, a new app turned up. Have I got something to do? Is there a ticket in Service Manager? Is there a job that I'm supposed to run when that application deployed? So the meshing together of all those system center components is one of the most powerful things that we have in the way we integrate across all of those products, all those components, I should say, and all those solutions coming together.
Great integration story there.
Yes, absolutely. So back to APM. So when we deploy an application, and we talked about the APM IIS management pack and the ability to turn on APM, under the management pack templates, we have the .NET application performance monitors. And I have one configured here already. I'll show you how this comes together by opening up this existing one. So when you go through the wizard, you see these exact same pages, okay? So I'm not showing you anything you've missed out on here. This is exactly what you see. It's a wizard that takes you through these five tabs. You can see we have two configured here. And when you first run it up, you can do a search, and it will show you all of the applications that are available to me that have been discovered. I didn't need to know where these apps were. In fact, it doesn't even tell me which servers these apps are running on. It actually doesn't matter. All I know is that I've got all these applications. You can see App Controller itself even turns up. We've got our dinner now demo applications. We've got some reporting services, and we've even got our standard stock trader demo app turns up there. This is the APM management pack, talking to the agents, discovering what's out there, and then bringing back all of the applications that are suitable to be monitored using application performance monitoring. I've selected the Dinner Now and the Dinner Now service application. That's literally the discovery, and I've chosen which apps I want to turn on. It really is that easy. The next thing I'm asked for is, well, for the server-side defaults, the back end, what do I want to turn on, and what are the threshold? Two questions. I can turn on performance events and exception events as well. So if an application error is thrown, do I want to know about that? And what is the acceptable response time that we have? In the client side, again, turn it on. Tick the box, it turns it on, it will automatically do this. Now the first time that you do this with an application, it will request a restart, an alert will be raised inside Operations Manager, and it will request the restart of both the application pools for IIS and a reset of IIS itself. Okay, so just be aware if you do this in production, do it in a change window because it's going to want to reset, IIS, and it's going to want to restart those application pools, meaning the application becomes unavailable for the duration of that reset. They're pretty quick, but just be aware there is an outage. The reason for that is twofold. One, when you turn APM on, there is a dormant service that gets installed with the Operations Manager agent. There's the Operations Manager service itself, and there's an APM service. It starts that service, it tells IIS that it's going to be doing performance monitoring and that it's going to be doing a pretty deep inspection of what's going on, and it needs IIS to restart to pick up that new configuration. That's what actually happens. Then on the client side, you turn on, again, performance events and exception events, and what is it you want to see, and what are the acceptable thresholds. There are a lot of advanced settings that you can turn on. You can filter out on IP addresses. In the advanced settings, you can do things like changing what percentage of the transactions do you want to monitor. Do you want to know about every single transaction that goes through the app? If you've got an app that's doing like 1,000 transactions a second, chances are you probably don't want every single instance going through. Maybe you only want 5%. But if you've got an app that's used only by 50 users and it doesn't matter, then maybe you want 100. Again, that's not a decision we can make for you. We simply give you the opportunity to choose how you do that. So once we've done all of that, and that's now configured, what happens is over in our monitoring tab, we now get a number of folders set up for us. These are all created dynamically. There's three screens that I'm going to show you that are not dynamically created, and I'll explain what those are. The first thing we see is in the application inventory, these are all those same applications that we saw in the wizard. So you get to see what the inventory looks like. In the monitored applications, we now see which ones of those we have turned APM on for. So we've got our big list, and now we know which ones we've turned it on for. It then creates a number of folder structures about our application. The Dinner Now application has a service, it has an application, and we also can get client-side off it. So therefore, we get three folder structures created, and for each of those, we get to see the performance data, and we get to see the overall health. When I look at Dinner Now, it's going to show me both. It's going to show me the both the service and the back end as well. And on the client side, it's only going to show me the alerts and information about the client information. You can create a number, and those are basic dashboards that are created without you doing anything. They just give you the state, they give you the alerts that are associated, and away you go. You can then build a number of dashboards, and I'm going to touch on those in a sec, but just to show what a couple of the options look like, you have things like targeting the summary dashboard, which tells you the state, gives you the performance information, and also the top five issues that are coming through. We can do service level dashboards where we can see how we're performing against our service level objectives, and we can see very, very quickly how in this example we have a 10-second target for our service level and we're operating at 15.5 seconds. So we're well over our threshold, but we can see it in a dial. It's really obvious. And everything that you can see in the Operations Manager console here is also available in the Silverlight Web console. So I can be delegated out the rights to just see my application and how I'm performing. All of this information is both IT as well as the application owner at the front end. And then you can build your own dashboards, and that ability to be able to configure these items on the way through. Each item that you see here is just a widget, and you can configure each of those widgets with different performance parameters, different alerts, and different state. Once you've turned all of that on and you're starting to get that visibility, we're going to jump over to our to our web console here, and we're going to load up a couple of different consoles. The first one is the application advisor, and the application advisor is the application owner's reporting mechanism. This is where, as an application owner, I can come here and get rich reports about how my application is performing. You can see there's a number of built-in reports here. We've got the application failure analysis. There's a number of reports that are available. And I can simply select what I want to know, select my applications, and run that report.
So who goes and builds this web-based report? Is that the IT guy, your operations manager guy?
So the application advisor reports are out of the box. Everything you're seeing here is out of box. I haven't created anything. I have a default install of Operations Manager. I've turned on the monitoring, and these are the reports I can run with no development at all.
Great.
Straight out of box.
But what if you wanted to add customized development? Do you need to learn any coding, or is everything wizard-based?
So there's two parts to that. Creating the dashboards that I was showing you in Operations Manager, that is, and I'll show you what that looks like, that is a right-click new dashboard. And you get to see that when I bring that up. I'm going to show you what that looks like in a demo in a sec. You can build your own dashboards in many different layouts out of box. There also is the ability to do custom development if you want, but we're sort of looking at SharePoint from a publishing mechanism, SQL reporting services, and the dashboards that we've got is pretty much going to cover everything that people will want to do in a very wizard-driven kind of way. If you wanted to do something that is kind of out there and very different and do some integration and from our partner ecosystem, then yes, you'll be able to do that as well. So in that application advisor, and my favorite is the summary failure analysis, because it's always good to know as an application owner what's going wrong and what's going on out there. So I'm simply going to move these dates back a little bit, run a report, and now we're going to see a summary view of how our application is performing. You can see that a good solid 97.3% of our applications are really running in a particular component. And if we take a look at what that looks like, we now can see down to the code level how these applications are running. We have the top five exception events for both our DIN and our application, as well as our DIN and our service. And when I drill into those, I get down to the line of code kind of information. Here's all the versions we've got, and I can drill in, and this is a very deep view into that's actually what was executed. I'm seeing the line of code that was executed as this ran and seeing what that exception actually was. I can share this dashboard with my developer because it's a web console, it's a delegated model. I can get the developers to be looking at this exact same information. There's no more finger pointing, there's no more, it's your infrastructure, it's my application. The finger pointing goes away when you can see the line of code that's causing the problem. If we take a look at the performance analysis, which is another favorite of mine, and we'll just roll those dates back a little bit as well, and run that report, I've now seen where the issues lie, but well, how's it performing? How's it going on? And what did I do wrong? Choose some dates that worked, that would help. And now that's going to load up the summary performance analysis. And we can see that the web service really is where our problems lie. 80% of all the performance problems that we've got in our application are through the web service. So it's kind of something we need to take a look at. Now we get to see a slightly different view. Now we're seeing where the performance issues are. Things are working, but they're slow. And we can see at the application, the back-end level, drilling in. Again, we get that exact same view, but this time when we're drilling in, we're starting to see some WCF issues because we've got a back-end application running there. If we take a look down the page a little bit more, now we're seeing some SQL queries that are causing problems. SQL is probably operating perfectly fine, but the statements that we're running in the SQL queries are not optimal. There's an issue. Possibly they're calling something wrong. This application is one that we kind of had a bit of fun with from our demo perspective. We gave our developers a perfectly working application and said, go have some fun and break it so we can get some information out. So there's some SQL queries in here. There's nothing wrong with dinner now. We've broken this badly in order to get the application information coming out. Excuse me. So the next thing we're going to take a look at is the application diagnostics. And this is a very developer view of the world. This is where we've moved away from the application owner, and this is really where the developer would sit. This is where they're coming in and they're seeing the hardcore kind of information that's going on. They can see all of the application calls that have been made. We're getting everything that's going on. And they can also see what the client looks like. So if I take a look at a client error coming out, we get a very graphical view about what your end user experience was. We can see that our threshold was set at 500 milliseconds, so half a second to respond. We've got a little bit of time on network, so network's probably okay. We've got this big long pink bit on the bar that you can see that is the server response time. So there's clearly a problem about we're asking for something and then something's going wrong at the back end. We just saw from the back end what that looked like in terms of there's a SQL query that's causing the problem. Now the developers and the application owners know where the problem lies. They can start working on that information. So we have a connector between Operations Manager and Team Foundation Server coming out. It's in CTP at the moment. And that's going to allow us to take these kinds of alerts and synchronize them across to TFS as a work item. And what that means is the developers are going to have into their specification and their work items, this is the error coming through, this is the work item that's coming up, and they can work on that, work on the incident, and provide an update to the application.
Could you just give a brief overview of what TFS is for
those
that might not be familiar with
it? Sure. So Team Foundation Server, that is the back-end storage, sort of, if you like, as with Outlook and Exchange, Visual Studio and Team Foundation Server. And basically, Visual Studio, when you open an application and develop, TFS is doing all of the code storage. So it's doing all the version controlling, it's doing all the storage of the raw source code, and delegating access out for that. So basically, it's a developer backend where all of the source code is. And so when a bug comes through, they now see the line of code causing the problem. They can go and look into TFS, pull that code up, start working on a bug fix. And then we talked about the application lifecycle coming through. We've just got this virtuous cycle going on that's going round and round. We know what's going on. We see the information coming through. We've got reports popping up. We've got monitoring and configuration going on. It's all starting to come together quite well.
Great.
Excuse me. So the last slide that I have, and then I'll go back to the demo again, is about those dashboards. And we talked about creating application dashboards. And pretty much, you know, it's great to have this information, but how do you share it? How do you make it available? And how do you drill down to all those perf Moncanos and all that information that's in a database? How do you visualize that and make it available? So it literally is a right-click, new dashboard view. Once you've done that, you get to choose a template layout, and I'll show you what this looks like. There's lots of different templates, ready built and made available. You configure the widgets. You can go through and select a bunch of different widgets, and then you delegate it out. So I can create a dashboard and a role. Excuse me, sorry. Delegate it out down to a single person or a group, and then you can hit the website and be able to launch that up.
Great. So we did have a question, and you may have touched on this already, but I just want to clarify this question here. For all the service level dashboards, is there any dependency on SharePoint, or can they all come out of the box?
So, excuse me. You can publish all of those dashboards to SharePoint. There is no reliance on SharePoint. Those dashboards that you are seeing are being developed or created inside the Operations Manager console. You can publish them, in which case they become available in the Silverlight web console with no development required. That's a publish mechanism. And then you can publish to SharePoint, whereas there is a SharePoint web part that pulls that through the web service.
Great.
There is no requirement for SharePoint. It is simply a way of publishing it out if that's the way you want to do it.
Great.
Okay, so let's go back to Operations Manager here. Excuse me. And we'll create ourselves a new dashboard and go through that and show you what that looks like. So when you bring up the dashboard wizard, the first thing you see is we have a number of templates available. Are we looking at doing a summary dashboard, a service level dashboard, or do we simply want to build our own and do a grid or a column layout? So we'll do a grid layout. We'll give it a name. So application dashboard demo. I'm really having trouble spelling today. Here we go. Chosen the name, click next. Now we get to choose what the layout is. You know, you can do anything from 1 to 9 kind of grid. There's a number of different layouts. I'm kind of a fan of the 5 grid layout with 3 at the top. It seems to look visually appealing to me. And we'll create that. That's now going to populate the Operations Manager database with a new dashboard view that is blank. And as it's creating that, very shortly it'll jump back to Operations Manager, and then we have the opportunity, excuse me, to go through and do that. So we now have a blank dashboard. You can see we've got 5 widgets available to us. None of them are configured. You simply click on each one to add a widget, and then it's going to say, what kind of widget do you want? You can do alerts. You can do instance details. You can do performance widgets. And you can do state widgets as well. So in the state widget, we'll just have our dinner now state. I'll just create one of these so you can see what it looks like. You can go through and from out of Operations Manager, these are all of the components that are available. We'll just take a look at the shopping cart just for argument's sake. Click next. Get to choose some options around how we configure that, what kind of display mode that we want. And that's it. That's it. We went through 5 clicks of a wizard, choose what we want out of the database. That is now going to populate the widget. And as we wait for that to refresh, just as an example, you can now see that in that watcher group, we've got a number of servers running, and we can see what that state is. So building up the dashboards, very point and click. It's bringing up all of that detailed information underneath. And if we jump to that one that we looked at earlier, Now, this dashboard took me around about 10 minutes to create, going through choosing the perf wine counters, configuring it, saying what I wanted. So 10 minutes to create a dashboard that really gives me a pretty quick view into what's going on. No development, out of the box, just surfacing all of that information.
No scanning through raw data, more importantly. Exactly. I mean, you see all the information there. And I mean, there's a lot of flexibility in the different widgets that you could choose, right, as you
Absolutely.
Show. So really,
yeah.
whatever you want, you could kind of get that now.
Yeah, and if you think about it, discovered my applications for me. All I did was import a management pack. That's the only action I had to take. I imported a management pack, it found my applications, put them in the list for me, I ticked some boxes to say yes, turn it on, set some thresholds, the alerts came through, and then all that information starts populating. Obviously this has got a few weeks worth of data here, and it takes some time to get the trending information coming through, but once you turn it on, it's all there, and you can just build that on top.
Now, a slightly broader question about Ops Manager, just beyond the application monitoring.
Sure.
Can we still do the same type of support for OS monitoring? Things such as, you know, making sure the OSs are healthy, looking at the start time, making sure that they're all booting healthy.
Sure. So, yes, absolutely. And I've shown you what the application performance monitoring looks like. As we showed in the slides, there is absolutely a requirement to have all of that base infrastructure monitoring. The management pack structures are still there. This is a build-on scenario where Operations Manager is just like it has been for all those years. You can still do all of the basics. And in fact, if I scroll down a little bit here and take a look at, say, the Windows Server, you'll see that all the different servers that I'm monitoring, I can still see the state of the underlying infrastructure. I can see these are the servers that I have running. Windows Azure does exactly the same, so we've got consistent monitoring across. You can see the hosted service that I have running, those roles that I showed you in Windows Azure and so forth. So that existing management structure still works. All management packs that worked in prior versions work with 2012, work very, very hard to make sure that there's consistency there. And certainly please let us know if you come across something in a management pack that doesn't work. That shouldn't happen, and if it does, then we want to know about it so we can fix it. But absolutely all management packs should continue to work moving forward.
Now, for this dashboard, what about being able to get data from a custom app from a third-party component? How can we go and pull that data and make a widget from it where we get that rich display?
Sure. So the widget is simply pulling all the information that's available that's been gathered through a management pack. So if you are monitoring an application, whether it's just Exchange or SharePoint or a custom management pack, that information is available, and when you go into the widget and click the button, you can expose all that information. If we choose a performance widget, it's going to give me all the performance information that's available, and I simply peer it down to the one that I want. So any information that is available in the Operations Manager database is available to be pulled into those widgets.
Great.
Okay, so we'll jump back and finish out the slide. We went through that one, sorry. Okay. So let's just revisit that application delivery lifecycle as we close out. And if we looked at the application specification, we talked about defining the resources, we talked about managing all those underlying resources, provisioning those resources between the virtual machine manager libraries and keeping them in synchronization, creating new service templates, publishing those service templates, making them available, the delegated delegation model, the authority and the quotas being enforced. As we deployed, we get to choose what those configurations are for the specific application and service that we're deploying. Moving into production, we have that ability with Serverat V to be able to do image-based patch updating and updating of the service template. Excuse me. And then from moving forward, being able to maintain the application as a whole and bringing that all together. And really, it's a very busy sidewall, that things that are on it now, but that life cycle is really the difference between where we are with traditional applications and operating systems and virtualization today and where we are with a private cloud. It's moving to that consistency model, the resiliency, and when we move into the monitor and operate content later on in the series, we'll see how this all gets lit up and how we can manage all of this stuff that we just deployed out today moving forward.
Great. Well, thanks for sharing. There was a lot of great content there. This wraps up the end of our first day. Tomorrow we will be back, so please join us again. We're going to start with Kenan in the morning, covering private cloud infrastructure and infrastructure components, how we optimize that infrastructure. Sean's going to come back, talk about service delivery and automation, and then Adam will join us once again for application management. But the big difference between today and tomorrow is that today really focused on the configuration and the deployment, getting it set up, getting it running. Tomorrow's going to focus on monitoring and operating it. So how do we really optimize it, take advantage of the advanced features, keep it up and running for as long as possible? So we certainly hope that you enjoy these presentations today. Please complete the survey, the poll at the bottom of your screen, and we will be back tomorrow. And remember, I think the word of the day is, can you do it with System Center 2012? Yes, you can. Thank you.